Hello and welcome to Build. I am Toby Tarrant, and as ever, we are live from London. And today I am delighted to be joined by Hannah John-Carmen and Shahzad Latif, two of the cast members from the new Netflix series, The Dark Crystal, Age of Resistance, created by the puppeteering legend Jim Henson. But before we chat to them, let's check out the trailer. How good does that look? Ladies and gentlemen, please give a huge Build welcome to Hannah John-Carmen and Shahzad Latif. Hello. Good to see you. Take a seat. Sit down where the mic is and talk into it. Thank you very much for joining us.
Thank you.
Thank you for having us.
Very lovely. Now, as ever, if you're watching live, remember you can tweet your questions at BuildSeriesLDN or leave a comment under the video if you are watching on Facebook. Thank you very much for joining us here at Build London. How are you? Okay?
I'm really well, thank you.
Good. Excited for the upcoming show?
So excited. Honestly, I'm such a huge fan of Dark Crystal anyway, so the fact that...
Yeah, I haven't seen the proper... anything really, we've just seen little bits.
Oh really, great. Yeah. Well, we'll come into that, we'll talk a bit about what the film meant to you when you were younger and stuff as well. So for those that don't know the story, people in the audience, people watching as well, tell us a bit about it, kind of explain the world of Fra without giving too much away at the same time, no pressure.
You've got, you know, lots of different clans, different Gelflings. I'm part of the Spriten clan. Our characters lead this little, try and go off and lead a rebellion and get everyone going against, you know, the Skeksis again. Is that enough?
Yeah.
Is that
so in this world of Thra, the Skeksis are in power over the Gelflings. And basically the Gelflings, it follows three Gelflings that basically light a fire, which sparks a huge rebellion and fighting against... the powers that be.
I mean, the original Dark Crystal, I remember watching it when I was a kid and stuff. It was a real cult classic. Mm-hmm. And you had seen it when you were younger, and you had seen it as well.
Yeah.
And it meant a lot to you when you were younger.
Yes, it was terrifying. I remember being so scared.
Yeah.
I was just so scared because I've got older siblings. So I remember just like watching it with them and just being terrified.
It's just etched in my nightmares, that
Dark Crystal.
I remember watching it and going to my mum, why did you let me see this? This is terrifying. Yeah. This is the worst thing that's ever happened to me. So, I mean, what was that moment like then when you got the call and they said, we're making it for Netflix and we want you to be in it?
Well, I remember my agents called me and basically said, right, hi, Hannah. So I just want to, you know, run this by you, Dark Crystal. And I went, yes.
Yeah.
And they said, but we haven't even discussed the deal. And I went, no, yes.
Yeah.
The answer is yes. I don't care. Get me in that. That's amazing. So, yeah, it was really
I think I was watching First Dates and then the audition came through and literally went into another room and just like read a little thing into like the iPad and then sent it off. And then I saw the cast list and I was like, whoa, this is a great cast and wanted to be part of it.
I love that you were watching First Dates. It was very honest of you as well. So the cast list, I mean, I've got some of the names in front of me. Helena Bonham Carter, Simon Pegg, Natalie Dormer, Taron Egerton. And the list goes on.
It's an
incredible list. Now, how much did you actually work alongside these people? Or have you two ever met before? Today's the first time we met.
Yeah, hi. Nice to meet you. Hi. Nice to meet you.
But genuinely, when you see those names, are you all off recording all around the world?
It's lonely. You're on your own.
You're on your own.
Really?
100%. You're on your own. And I remember being really nervous because I went in and you just kind of, you know, by yourself and... you're kind of going wild in the booth. And I was like watching the scene with like a few of us Gelflings. And I'm going, oh, I wish that we were all here.
Really? So when did you guys come together? When did you start meeting one another then? Well,
As soon as I said to the director, Louis, I was like, I want to have a big party to meet everyone. Because otherwise we're not going to see each other until the premiere. But today is the first time we met, yeah.
Oh, really? It genuinely is? Oh, that's adorable.
There she is.
Now, there's so many... creatures and characters and so many names to remember as well. So we've got the Skeksis, obviously, which are, you know, the bad guys. The Grottons, the Stonewood, you play Gelflings, who are brand new characters. So what can you tell us about Gelflings generally?
We're Spritons.
There's different clans. You've got the Grottomans, which are underground.
We're sort of like hunter-gatherer, our little clan.
We're warriors. Like I feel because Onaya, she's a warrior. She's very strong, and they're hunters. Mm. And you have different kind of groups of the Gelflings.
Right. Because I was looking through all the names then, and I remember the film vividly, but I was going, there's a lot to remember. And then it's got this real die-hard, loyal fan base as well. So, I mean, what is it about, do you think, the world that Fra's created that has attracted that really loyal fan base? Because they're die-hard.
Yeah.
I suppose you got the extra thing of the puppetry,
yeah,
which just draws them in, which is, yeah, Jim Henson. It's just that style is so recognisable and beautiful and wonderful and layered. And now we've got 10 eps to explore it, so it's, you know.
Yeah.
And just when I think of childhood, I just think of, you know, the films like Dark Crystal, Labyrinth, Goonies, you know, just all these films that you just etched into your brain because it just reminds you of your childhood.
Yeah, and also, I mean, you guys have both been in other blockbuster films, so you'll have experience of this kind of fanatical fan base as well. So are you excited to meet these fans, or are you going to be putting restraining orders in and keeping a distance away from them?
Very excited.
I'm excited. I love it.
Yeah, it's like, yeah. You know, sharing that imaginary world with other people is a nice thing.
Yeah, well, they are absolutely diehard. I have to admit, I'm a bit of a geek out about this as well. you know, it's funny because when I said to people I was interviewing you guys as well, everyone you go, the Dark Crystal, they go, oh, mm-hmm. I love the Dark Crystal growing up as well. Talk about the puppetry as well, because it's very different the way that this was done. So, I mean, I'm very much simplifying it because it's far too intelligent for me, but basically the puppetry was kind of done and then the puppeteers were taken out afterwards in front of a green screen. So, as an actor and actress, how difficult was that? Because you did the speaking after the action had already been done, is that right?
Yeah, we were very late. I was very late to the game. I mean, I literally came in and saw already, like, the shots and the scenes that had been shot, and I was like, oh, wow. And I remember at one point... you know, that my puppet Naya, like, there's like tears in her eyes. I'm going, wow, she can act. She's awesome. And it was interesting to kind of follow the lead of the puppeteers, but it was amazing because it gave my puppet a lot of character because her mouth kept on opening when other people are talking. So I just started to put a lot of grunts in.
Right.
So it kind of gave her personality, you know.
Yeah. You're sharing the role with someone else. It's two people playing this role. Is, you know, Victor is the guy that did my character Kylan,
right?
And it's a two-person thing. Yeah. You're creating this thing together, even though we're doing it, you know, months after.
I guess the weird thing about doing it that way around as well is, like, when they put the film in front of you, it's all kind of ready made. You're going, wow, this looks amazing. It's now down to me to make sure that it finishes.
Yes. Yeah.
I thought my puppet's voice was better than mine. I was like, you should keep his voice.
I said that as well. Yeah, yeah. I said, she's great. Yeah. But I remember kind of being really nervous, though, on that, my first day coming in, because I was like, oh, my God, you know. And just seeing suddenly when you kind of see on the ADR screen or you just see the puppets and you go, oh, my gosh, this is, I'm really here.
Yeah.
It's Dark Crystal.
Well, you've both absolutely smashed it. We can have a little look now, actually. So we have got a clip from behind the scenes of the making of Dark Crystal. This looks awesome. Take a look. So cool. It's so cool. Now, you've both been involved in films of CGI, so you know that works. Were you ever worried about this and thinking, is this going to be as good as CGI? Or did you see it first day and go, wow?
Yeah, straight away, I just thought, this is unbelievable. And it feels alive. There's something about those puppets that when you, it helps you even, you know, getting into the role and all that kind of stuff. There was something about the way it was done that it's an extension of the puppeteer's arm, you know. It's a beautiful, beautiful thing.
And there's also kind of like a kind of gorgeous nostalgic thing with seeing that and the puppets and, you know, knowing of Jim Henson's puppets and kind of you kind of feel connected.
Mm. Yeah. And
rather than disconnected.
That was what I found odd looking at it, was that you know they're puppets, but you really become attached to them on like a human emotional level. And yeah, I don't know what it is about the puppetry that does that. Did you feel that when you were acting?
Yeah, there's something about the eyes. There's an innocence there. It draws you in. I don't know what it is, yeah.
Yeah, it was. It really
is. I think it's a detail of just and the expression and you know, in the emotion coming out of this puppet, and then you kind of, it draws you to kind of, you know, exchange, and it's amazing.
Did you, when you first got there, like first day of set, and they've got the puppet in front of you, you start doing the lines, were you a bit apprehensive and a bit not kind of working it out, or did you just go, I've just got to throw myself into this and just kind of let it go?
Well, I never saw my puppet. Yeah. I literally went to Goldcrest Studios went in there and saw what the art that they've already created and, you know,
it's
joined in.
You're creating, I mean, you can only do so much before you see what's on screen. So you're sort of creating with the director, with these sound people, and you're sort of on the spot. It's quite vulnerable. You're sort of creating in the moment, and it's quite scary, but it was a joy.
Yeah,
it was a joy.
It really was. Because you have like a kind of a breakdown of your character. So it's kind of like, right, so this is what we're looking for and this is the character. And then you kind of, you go in and it just all unravels and happens because you kind of, it's like I said, creating in the space.
Did it ever feel really weird? Did you ever go into the booth and make a load of grunts and general noises and then go, I was watching First Dates a week ago and I've just spent a room in a
and now I'm singing. I had to do a song. The director was like, oh, don't worry, we'll get someone to do it. And then he went, do you want to try it? And I went, all right, you sure? And he said, I said, you're probably going to have to auto-tune it or something. And I sang the weirdest song you're ever
heard. I was rehearsing it in my kitchen.
Well, I was, yeah.
I was singing in my kitchen. My dog was looking at me bizarrely.
It's very scary.
So what? So did you have a song as well? Yeah. Now, look, I think it would only be nice to the people that have kindly given up their afternoons to give us a little bit of...
I don't even remember. It's a different language. I don't even remember what it is.
We're
willing to go with it. I mean, we don't mind if it's in a different language. I mean, you could give it a go.
Last line, I think, was like, Poo Oom Sa. That's how it looked.
Brilliant.
Yeah, that was
and
it.
A round of applause, please, for Poo Oom Sa, which is it's a hell of a song.
It sounds better than that on the...
sure. So you got a song given to you in a different language and you had to learn...
Yeah, like in 6 hours.
Did they ever tell you what you were singing or have they stitched you right up? You could be singing anything.
I could, yeah. Yeah, I'm an idiot. You know,
that's what I really hope. Now, the director, Louis Leterrier, who has kind of made his name in film mainly, but because these are quite epic episodes, they feel like miniature films. They're an hour long as well. So did that experience, was that really useful when he was directing you?
He didn't sleep. He was like on 2 hours sleep. He was doing like voice sessions in LA, voice sessions here. He was DOP. You've just seen him there moving with the camera. He'd done so much stuff and he's got a real passion for it. And he made it really easy for us.
For us. And also just to even have that ear to listen and hear out for each line and see which one works. And because you're literally doing it line by line. And yeah, like you
to
said.
To hear the same thing over and to pick
yeah,
it out
to, to know exactly which one. And also to, like you said, all of us actors were spread all over the world. So time differences and...
Is there a lot of that thing where they... Where you're on the other side of the screen, they're going, can you just say that sentence again, but put the emphasis on this bit and the emphasis on this
bit? There
is
a bit of that.
A lot of repetition.
Yeah.
Can be a little bit of that.
Now, the film was obviously huge, as we touched on in the 80s, real cult classic. When you work on a project like this, I could tell you guys have really enjoyed it and you're excited about it and stuff. Do you set any goals, any ambitions? Because obviously the film was very successful. Are you kind of sitting here going, I want this to be a huge hit on Netflix?
Yeah.
Absolutely. Yeah. I love it to be a huge hit because it's just, you know... I just think as well for people who, you know, are fans, because it is a cult classic, and for people who haven't seen it, for a new generation, to get excited about this because it's so different. And, you know, I appreciate CGI a lot, but this is so different, and I think it'd be really nice for...
I think a new generation to get involved with puppetry.
Yeah,
I want my niece and nephew to, you know, enjoy that. I don't think even...
It's old school. And, you know, for us growing up watching The Muppets and Jim Henson, but you can't imagine them ever coming up. Where did this darkness come from? The Muppets is they're adorable. And then he's making stuff like that. I don't know where it came from. Did any of the work that you've done in those CGI films, because you've been in some basically as big as it gets blockbuster-wise, you know, Marvel, Universal, Star Trek and stuff. So did any of that experience help you with this at all, or was it a completely different...
I think it was quite different, yeah.
It was just completely new for me, to be honest. It was a really, really... wonderful new thing, and I love doing that in my career. I like doing something completely different that I haven't done before, and I loved it. It was so interesting. It is really weird to kind of have your puppet already performing, and then you've got to keep up as an actor with the amazing acting that your puppet's just done.
I love that you sat there going, wow, this puppet
this
can act.
This puppet can act. thanks, Naya.
And it's been released globally on Netflix. So sometimes they stagger it, so it comes out in different countries at different times. This just goes out at once. Is that really terrifying, really exciting, a bit of everything?
I think it's exciting because you can just, you know, go on holiday to Turkey and be like, oh, just seen Dark Crystal and just meets, you know, it's that beautiful thing where you can go anywhere in it.
But also, it's an, you know, incredible actors in this series, and it's one of those things where you're going to have to go on IMDb and see who's voicing who after, because even from watching it, you just don't know. People sound so different.
Yeah.
And it's really cool, the characters.
I do that geeky film thing, because I'm a film nerd, where as soon as anything's coming out, you scroll down on IMDb. But with this one, I've just never seen anything like it. It just kept going. We've got a question on social. Somebody tweeted in with a question. It is for Hannah. Sorry. It's for Hannah from Will in East London, who says, are you going to be involved in any future Marvel films whilst we've got you here?
Well, Marvel have made me sign my contract in blood.
Only blood, and also
stitched my mouth together. The only thing I can say, which is just, this is just a fact, is that you don't see Ghost die at the end of Ant-Man and the Wasp. And that's it.
Okay.
That's just a fact.
That's it. So basically, I'm going to take that as a resounding yes. I think we can all agree. Yeah.
I'd love to.
Exactly. And yourself as well. Any exciting projects that you can actually tell us about? Any films you didn't die in?
I don't. I'm not. I'm. there's things in the pipeline, but I'm not doing anything right now. I'm on a little break.
Okay. So, you've earned it.
I'm going to go on holiday.
Okay. When you say holiday, do you mean you're
going
to be...
Well, I'm going to Copenhagen in the 3:50 this tomorrow morning.
Oh, right. I was picturing you in your underpants eating cereal watching First Dates again. That's what I thought. But
I'll probably do that, yeah, in Copenhagen.
Yeah, I thought it was going to be back to square one. We have got one more social question as well coming in, which is the tin of my ear. Are we going to see any more of Clem Fandango in Toast? Is the question that I have been asked. And I think that might be a fan question that's come in my ear in the last second.
I think Matt Berry released that thing saying he wanted to write a fourth series, but he's just really busy right now. So it will take some time. But he released that thing saying he will. So I would love to do that again.
Yeah, exactly. Well, one of my friends' name on Facebook is Clem Fandango, just as a tribute. So, you know, take that as the ultimate compliment, if Brilliant. You will. Thank you guys so much. I cannot thank wait for this TV show. It looks absolutely awesome. So thank you for bringing back a cult classic that scared me so much in my childhood and making it even scarier for 10 hours longer. So thank you very
thank
much.
You,
thank you.
Thank you so much, everybody. Hannah and Jazad, everybody. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
That is all that we have time for with Hannah and Jazad. The Dark Crystal Age of Resistance will be released on the 30th of August on Netflix. Worldwide. You heard that, worldwide. We'll be back shortly with songstress Ella Eyre to talk all about her new single, Mama. But for now, give it up one last time for Hammer and Suzanne, everybody.